calling out all my nerds, freaks, and geeks. It's mob time.
Don't tune in, cause it's showtime. Go ahead and call the gang up for the one time. Rap food rhymes, got them on the line. And my life's still great, I'm doing just fine. Hands up!
What's up, y'all, and welcome to the Blerd Mob, your hub for all things black and nerdy. I'm your host, Foop, joined by my co-host, Ryan. If you're listening to this on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and any other streaming service, make sure you hit that follow button so you can get updates from the mob.
And whether you're a member of Team Black or Team Green, make sure you like this video, subscribe to the channel, turn those bell notifications for future uploads, and I'm not going to go into in-depth, but y'all should get it by now. Leave some comments, engage with us, follow us on all social media platforms, and continue to support.
All right. Yeah, let us know how you're feeling about this episode. Today, we are going to be doing a mob review on House of the Dragon Season 2. And once again, I forgot to look up the stuff. All right. House of the Dragon, the first episode debuted for Season 2 on June 16th, 2024. And the last episode dropped August 4th, 2024, ending Season 2 with 8 episodes. So you guys already know how this goes, unless this is your first time here. All of our reviews are spoiler filled. So if you have not seen House of the Dragon Season 2, or if you're not caught up yet, I would recommend pausing this video, going to get caught up, and coming back and listening to the conversation. So let's go ahead and get into gear. How did you feel about Season 2 overall, Ryan?
I ain't gonna lie. It took a lot for me to not get really mad about the finale like everybody else and just act like Season 2 was boo-boo garbage. It was cool. It was a decent season. It wasn't as good as Season 1.
Definitely.
It did not amount to the quality of some of the better seasons of GOT, i.e. Seasons 1 through 5, especially 4 and 5.
Mm-hmm.
But it did a decent job at letting me know what should be the vibe for season 3, and now that we're out of Luigi's mansion, hopefully it's going to be fine.
Hey, look, that was my least favorite plot line of season 2, but I would have to agree season 2 was solid. I know a lot of people were upset about the last episode that I felt like what maybe took us all in the wrong direction is that the way they made it seem like that the shit was going to go down in this season, like everything that, you know, season one built up to, like shit was going to hit the fan this season. At least that's how I felt. And it was a bit more, some shit hit the fan, but it was more so build up. And then that last episode was like the ultimate edging. And then, okay, season 3, shit's finna go down. See you guys 2026. And it was kind of like, I thought this was the season.
Yeah, because it's like this season, we got like, what, 2 really high highs.
We got
probably one third one that wasn't as high, but it was like, okay, someone's life is at risk. But outside of that, it was a lot of lows. Like, it was a lot of lows and a lot of mids.
I would say it was a lot of exposition, a lot of dealing with characters. I know one of, even though I said it's my least favorite plot line, it is, but I saw a lot of people who have read the books were talking about they don't really talk about what Daemon was going through when he left Dragonstone. So I feel them on giving one of like the high level characters, Daemon, who like basically stamped his place in a lot of people's like favorite House of the Dragon characters season 1, and giving him like, let's explore what he was really doing in Harrenhal. They could have did some other shit. Like even with the discussions and everybody talking and plotting and Rhaenyra trying to keep the peace, they could have showed me anything else. But Daemon in that damn castle.
And I got two things about that. Like, I think I didn't go back and watch our full review for season 1, but Daemon was indeed my favorite character. And this season made me forget why. I'm like, I can't even remember. I'm like, did I like Daemon? But I'm like, no, he was such a polar. He wasn't necessarily good in terms of like lawful good versus chaotic bad and all of that. Mm-hmm. But he was just polarizing. He had a lot of aspects to him that made you either really like him or really hate him, which is a good character. But him playing Luigi, I didn't enjoy that. I didn't see the point in it. I mean, yeah, we got a little bit of some spiritual stuff, the stuff that leads into GOT, and I know we're going to get into that. But mm-hmm. I was like, this could have been in an email. The amount of screen time we spent seeing him in Harrenhal was unnecessary. It did not add much, in my opinion.
I would agree. I don't think it really brought its value to the season until the last episode, until he finally got his army, until he finally got that vision. I would maybe even say the second to last episode, when Oscar Tully let that man have it, and then we go into episode 8 when he has that vision and he starts getting his shit together, and then it's like, okay, here we go. My whole thing is with like the haunted dreams and stuff, like when we talk about Alice Rivers, he sees her, calls her a witch, and then proceeds to drink the spooky juice from this lady that you just called a witch. And now you tripping at the ends, tripping and falling, hallucinating, you doing the nasty with your mother. And I was just like, what is this leading to? That's the part that got me. When I was like, what is this leading to? Like the visions of like Rhaenyra talking to him and the visions of like Viserys and stuff like that. I was like, okay, he's just going through like one of those fever dream type things. And I was like, okay, I get it. But then when it got to the mama vision, I was like, okay, it's time to wrap this up. It's time to wrap this up. It's time to get this man army. He don't want to talk to Rhaenyra. Rhaenyra don't want to talk to him. I was like, listen, can we focus on anybody else?
And here's the issue. His plot didn't amount to much. Like, I saw someone tweet, and this was my second issue with Daemon's storyline. They was like, people who just wanted to see fights and everything was mad about the exposition in this season are the reason why GOT failed in season 7 and 8. And it's like, no. When Game of Thrones slowed down to show conversations, politics, and exposition, it impacted the overall story. Plot changed. Some of the biggest plot points came from those moments. It wasn't even the battles, to be honest. But with Daemon, at first he was serving Rhaenyra, bent the knee, and said, I will serve you. And throughout all his little Harrenhal plot, we just come back, and I'm still serving you. But now I know that one of our ancestors is going to fight the Winter and fight the White Walkers. Like, that's it. All we got out of all of this was, we're back to you serving Rhaenyra, and now you have a reason for it, an extra reason to serve her.
I would say,
what progression did we get with him as a character? He's still going to be impulsive. Let's be honest. That's not going to stop nothing.
I feel like we just ended up, I feel like, you know, now that we've seen all 8 episodes, I feel like he just ended up where he ended up in the last season. Like, the conflict of, like, you know, does he want the throne? Does he not? And then I feel like at season 1, we established Daemon doesn't want the throne. He's just going to stand by Rhaenyra's side. And then we get to the end of season 2, and then it's like, okay, once again, Daemon doesn't want the throne. He's going to stand by Rhaenyra. But I was like, well, we kind of already went through this in season 1. There was no growth. Like, I get it that this was an opportunity for the show writers to expand on something that wasn't given much light in the book. However, I got tired of that shit real quick. When we got to episode 4 and he was still in that castle having nightmares, it was really the doing the nasty with the mother vision for me, and I was like, okay, it's really time to wrap this shit up.
Out of all the incest, that shouldn't have bothered you that much. We were seeing brothers and sisters do it on hay barrels.
But I'm just saying. 3. But I'm look, listen, listen.
I get it, but come on now.
This is what I'm trying to say. If we're going to expand on his storyline to something that is supposed to be integral to the plot, why are we doing that? And what did that give us? What did that, for seeing that right there, what did that give us?
It didn't give us anything.
And like, that's what I'm saying. And that was my point of saying it's time to wrap this shit up, because what are we doing?
And that's my thing. Like, if they were to utilize his plot line for anything that was
are they even gonna come back to it? Cause now the way they setting up for like season three, we finna go to war. And is there anything that we saw in that castle? Any of those hallucinations that's going to be like, okay, I remember this from season two.
I feel like the most important or most gratifying part from his plot line was the stuff he did with them families. Who were the two families that were fighting at first? The Browns and the what else?
It was the Brackens and somebody else.
And that team, honestly, I would have liked to just see their stuff. Like, they got a little battle going on. We saw a whole bunch of dead bodies. We ain't see none of the battle. I'm like, forget Daemon over here crashing out over crack juice. We could watch these families fight and see what's going on over here.
We
did not have to see him having nightmare after nightmare for like what, 4 or 5 episodes in a row. I'm telling you,
when we got to episode 4, I was like, okay, he's just having nightmares in the castle. Like, out of everything else that was going on in there, because we got some episodes where people were just talking, even though like we had those couple episodes where people were fighting, but even some of the episodes where people were just having conversations and communicating and stuff, I was like, okay, I can see how this leads into the plot. I see where this can lead to going next. Oh, I can see how this interaction might bite somebody in the ass going forward. But that right there, that if out of everything, that is my major complaint. And I wish, and half of it is like, not even half of it. That's why I feel like they should have had more episodes. Cause now we get to the episode 8. We didn't endure this whole man's haunted house, haunted mansion plotline just for us to get to episode 8 for him to end up doing the same thing that he did at the end of season 1.
I don't think if they didn't need more episodes, I think they should have just better produced and directed this. I'm gonna be honest. That man, I don't know the math. Someone's probably going to drop it. His screen time was probably like at least an hour. Out of all his time in Harrenhal, we've seen that man wake up in the same room, the same nightmare, somebody outside with a blade or a torch, like 3 to 5 times. Yeah. We saw him hold a blade and threaten the old dude who was over Harrenhal multiple times.
But do you feel like if they had more episodes, they could have spaced out those where it's not like an every episode type thing? We didn't need to see that much anyway.
Nothing came out of it. Like, even if they say the books didn't really tell us what Daemon went through, once y'all told us what he went through, it was not relevant. Out of everything we got out of that, okay, he touched the tree, he saw some stuff with the three-eyed raven and some stuff that go into the religion of GOT, cool. He serves Rhaenyra again. He got her an army like he said he was going to in the beginning. Nothing really changed. Nothing impactful really came out of that, except for those two families that probably fought each other. Well, not probably, but did fight each other.
I don't know. I'm gonna go under the impression that maybe if they had a couple more episodes, we could have gotten a different type lineup.
Man, I think the showrunners probably just realized that, not the showrunners, probably all of them, probably realized that Daemon was a fan favorite. He's expected to be a fan favorite. I think even George R. R. Martin said he was one of his favorites. I feel like they just realized we got to give him some screen time, because if we dismiss him for like 3 to 4 episodes, people are going to be upset.
That's what it gave to me. If this was the outcome of that, I would not have missed him for 3 episodes.
But here's the thing, we wouldn't have known it. If they didn't show this, all we would have been like is, where is our boy Daemon? Everybody's in the field. Like, the same way we were saying, get in the field in that one mid-season review, we would have said, where is Daemon? We need him in the field, if we didn't see Daemon.
That's fair. I see it from both ends. I don't know. We got
they
it
wasted
now.
His screen time.
I agree. And now they finna get into it next season. That's crazy. But moving on from our rant of Daemon Targaryen, like, how'd you feel about everybody else this season?
In terms of everybody else, I got more pissed off with Alicent and Christian Cole, especially in the beginning. Christian Cole was kind of humanized. later on to where I felt bad for him because he saw the results of war. That's not, I got to give it to him. I like that he wasn't Mr. Superman and he actually got depressed from it and upset from it because that's what you would expect from a soldier in those type of situations. Aemond, still evil douchebag. I don't know what to say. To be honest, the character who probably got the most growth, and this might be a hot take, was old girl who was supporting Rhaenyra. The one who started off as like Masaria. In terms of her coming up the ranks, starting to help the queen become a secondary love interest and everything else, in terms of like character evolution, I liked hers the most. I don't feel like we got much out of Rhaenyra, if we're being honest.
Is it really evolution though, or did she just get more screen time? Because she was just doing the same thing she was doing in season one, but doing it for Rhaenyra.
I mean, I like that she was actually impacting other characters. I like that what she did actually was like relevant and actually like pushed the story forward. Because not too many people, if we're being honest, really did that.
I would agree with you that her coming to the forefront and helping out Rhaenyra and pushing some of those plot lines forward, yes. But I don't know if I agree with you as far as like character development. Because I honestly feel like she's just the same person from season one, but working for Rhaenyra.
Who do you think isn't in that same boat in terms of they not the same person?
Is they not the same person?
In terms of character growth. You got to think too hard. All these
But that just goes, it, because I was thinking about this earlier and going back to your comparison of season one, like we had a lot of characters to like latch onto just because of the way they were introduced and how they progressed. I didn't find myself like really rooting or latching on to anybody this season. Like anybody.
I latched on more to the dragons.
I really don't like. I didn't see any, I mean, if we want to talk about change, we got Alicent that finally got her head out of her ass and realized this whole time, like, you were just being dumb. Like, you started this whole thing. Like, some development.
Alicent still taking Plan B juice.
She only took it one time.
Didn't she take, she took it once in season one. You forgot that?
No, that was Rhaenyra.
Oh, it was Rhaenyra who took the Plan B juice. Okay.
That was how the whole beef got started.
I thought Alicent took the Plan B juice.
No, Alicent was all like the righteousness. That was her whole thing. Like, I'm going to only sleep with my husband. These my husband kids. Like, I don't get down. I don't ride like that. And then we get to season two and then she done made a whole 180. She's doing a whole 180. And it was like, oh, girl. And then she gets to the end. She finally is just like, you know, I was wrong, and she, you know, basically letting go of all of those morals and beliefs that she held on to so hard in season one. So, I mean, if we want to talk about growth, you may not see it as positive, but if you want to talk about somebody who did a 180,
I'll give you this: there was change in her. I feel like it could have been depicted better. Because how did you put it on Twitter? She went on her spiritual journey and jumped in the river. I was like, what in the, I don't even know what to refer it to.
I think I would say
like some out of a psychedelic dream or something.
I don't think it was the river. I think it was everything that was building up to that point. Cause like as soon, whatever episode that was, when she found out that she might possibly be wrong, that's when we really visually started seeing the change. And then it got to Aegon getting hurt, her getting kicked off the council. Then Aemond shutting her out, Christian Cole doing whatever. She just, you know, started feeling real icky about him. And now she's coming to terms with everything. Then we get to the river scene. And then it's like, oh, I'm, you know, bathe myself and be free. But I feel like they set up some of her pieces where I was looking like, yeah, Alicent, like you caused all this, like all of this is your fault.
But that's what I'm saying. At this point, unless she pulls like a Cersei, because Cersei was such a polarizing character, y'all just gotta offer as like punishment or something. Like, she, like, y'all can't deliver her character redemption because there's no route for that.
I honestly don't think Game of Thrones is one of those franchises and House of the Dragon where I just don't feel like there's redemption. Is there redemption?
But that's what I'm saying. At this point, all y'all can really do is offer. It's not like she can be utilized at this point to, like, help anything. Like, Aemon ain't gonna be like, oh, let me save her and go fight. Aegon ain't finna do that. He like the crippled dude more.
Yeah, and Aegon gone. He on his way to Essos.
Her daughter is basically a three-eyed raven. So,
I feel like Helaena's thing was a bit. Another reason why I feel like they should have had more episodes, because let's go early in the season. That blood and cheese situation, I feel like should have affected her, or at least shown that it affected her and like her relationship with everything like going on a bit more. It was kind of like it happened and now she back having visions and telling riddles.
Yeah. I feel like we should have saw the most we saw, she ran away. She sat there with like her baby in her hand. We saw her panic ever so slightly. And it's like, we didn't get, like, you just saw your baby get slain in front of you and you're not a fighter. Even Rhaenyra remembers you as not someone who's a soldier, not someone who's going to ride their dragon in a war. And it's like, we don't see you have a freaking breakdown. We don't see how this impacts the way your relationship with your brothers and the ones who are kind of participating in this war. Like, we should have saw more character growth from her. We saw her at the end when she snapped in the finale.
Yeah.
And was that really a snap? Like,
it could have just been her being fed up. Because, like, the pieces that we did get after Blood and Cheese, it was like Aegon didn't know how to talk to her or console her. So maybe I felt it as maybe she saw it as that she just had to internalize all of it.
What type of relationship did her and Aegon even have?
I mean, but like, as your husband and as the king, like, you could have said something. Like, when they met on those steps, he could have said something. He looked at her and kept walking. And she and her, the face that she kind of had was like, oh, okay. And then went back to her business.
But that's what I'm saying. I kind of wish, like, this is why I say I don't think it's necessarily that they needed more episodes. They should have just better prioritized their time. Because even her relationship with Aegon, I don't feel like we got much. Like, does he hate her? Is it like, oh, I sleep with her because I got to? Like, but we kind of get that, but like, we could have seen some of that.
But I feel like, given where they were trying to push the overall season towards, I feel like those two additional episodes would have helped adding a bit more depth to those situations, as well as moving forward the plot. Because if we only have 8 episodes and we want to get to A to B, do we spend a lot of time, you know, doing a bit more exposition and deep dive, knowing where we need to end up at the end of these 8 episodes? Or do we just kind of like do a little 1-2 like they did and keep it pushing?
They didn't do 1-2 with the Harrenhal accident.
I would argue that I would argue if I was to lean on your argument with 8 episodes, I would argue that if they had done that, then we would probably be still having the same type of complaint.
I don't think so, only because I really want to see how much time was dedicated to Daemon. Because if you sit down and say, okay, what were the major points, whether it be political or whatever, that happened in House of the Dragon season 2. For example, Aegon taking the throne was a major one. His Otto being kicked out, as he was one of the ones who basically played a huge part in everything that's going on. Yeah. Rhaenys dying, which I felt like was perfectly executed. I had no issue with how
that. Rook's rest was the best episode out of that season. Let's just talk. Keep going, but we gonna spend the block on Rook's wrist. Yeah.
But you see what I'm saying? Like, that was fine. The scene where with the dragon seeds, where Rhaenyra was trying to get someone to ride Vermithor and Sea Smoke and the other dragons, that episode, pretty decent. Like, those moments were well executed. But everything else could have either been cut down or modified.
But also my point is that the scenes that you pointed out are major plot points that have to move us forward into season 3. Like, Rhaenys dying is a major plot point. Rhaenyra finding those dragons and finding Rhaenys' form is a major plot point.
So that's what I'm saying. When you're looking at a tree and you're looking at the main branch and you're looking at where you're looking at the trunk and you're looking at all the branches that add into that, Harrenhal was a big branch for no reason. Most of that, we could have saw Daemon only have like one fever dream. And we could, and honestly, yes, we would have been like, where's Daemon? Where's our polarizing character? Mm-hmm. But for what we got, I would have rather chose that if it meant more time with Aegon and his wife's sister. More time seeing, I guess, Alicent deal with the traumas of actually being a woman who is now being ostracized by all the men in the group, even though she thought she was in power. More mm-hmm. time to see Rhaenyra get a little ferocious, because most of this season, she kind of stayed flat. We saw her get a little upset. Like, mm-hmm. we saw her get upset, but the bold little girl that we saw from season 1, we only saw bits and pieces of that. I would have mm-hmm. wanted a little bit more of that, too. Just being honest. Even Corlys, I mean, we saw your son snap on you, but you got no reaction out of you.
I was so sick. Every time we see Corlys, he at that damn boat. I was like, I'm so sick and tired of seeing him at this damn dock.
He just had his lip low. Like, that's all that dude did. That's all he did was walk around like this.
He showed up to Dragonstone one time and went back to that damn boat.
He didn't even act like a hand for real. Can we be honest? Like, if he was to be a hand, he would have been like, yes, that is my son. Should we use my other son to ride a dragon? Like, he could have done so much. And I get it. Oh, he got to follow the traditions. But that fell flat for me. Because what did he do?
I feel like, and very ironic to say, because this is something that I feel like the Game of Thrones franchise has done really well. Did we just have too many characters in this season? Because we're trying to follow existing characters and new developments. While and then they were introducing Adam. What's his face? What's the other brother that snapped on him?
Just say Baldy and Dreads. I don't remember everybody's names.
I'm not calling them that.
Baldy and Black Dreads. That's what you call it. Baldy and Black Dreads.
And Alan. There we go. Adam, Alan, Ulf, Hugh. I'm trying. And I guess like Allison's brother. Like, we're trying to introduce all of these new characters. The end of the episode where Tywin is off in Essos meeting this lady. And we got Alice Rivers and all these other people that we're trying to, like, build up and make something of. Is it possible that maybe we had too many people in the pot for 8 episodes in season 2?
It could be too many characters, but I will always come back to this. I wonder if the writers just struggled to garner that character depth that we saw when the Game of Thrones writers were adapting the source material. Like, maybe because to remind me, ain't Fire Blood basically written like a history book? It's not really, really written like a story novel. It's more so written like a history book. That's what I saw going on social media.
I have the book. I haven't read it. So if that is how it's read, then, okay, if that's how it is read, I can see maybe to where there's some difficulty trying to adapt that into a narrative, because the Game of Thrones books are written as narratives.
Yeah, from what I saw, and fans, when y'all watch this, let me know, correct me in the comments. But, like, from what I was hearing, it's basically written like a history novel, and the writers of the show, well, the showrunners have to figure out how to fill in the blanks. And they kind of can play with it a little bit, because it's like the winners write history. So we're going to show y'all the real history. And it makes me wonder, did y'all just struggle with some of these characters? Because a lot of them fell flat.
And that's what I feel like. And that's going back to my point of, like, I couldn't really latch on to anybody this season.
Not at all.
And that could have very well have been the reason. Like, now we're in the thick of it. Like, season 1 is introduction, building up the conflict, and I think they did a damn good job of building all that up. And now we're in the conflict, and now we need to introduce these new players, and it just felt like we didn't know who to expand on, who not to expand on. And I feel like, going back to the Daemon thing, I feel like the Daemon thing was the wrong decision.
Yeah, I feel like if anybody had to go, honestly, yes. Give Daemon, cut his time by like 80%. We didn't need it. Corlys and his kids, honestly, I would have liked a little bit more object, just a little bit, just a tad bit. Just a tad bit out of Aegon and his sister too. And Rhaenyra, for the time we got out of her, I would have loved to see Jace more. I feel like Jace had his moments where he was about to go off.
He had his moments where he was handling business too. And I hate that this Daemon thing is like overshadowing a lot of good things that happened in this season, because if we like the blood and cheese, even though it wasn't done like in the book, I thought that was the moment, like, damn, Daemon, like, what's really going on? And then Jace handling his business by securing the Starks and the twins. And then you have the, can't remember what episode that was, but the episode with Eric and Arik fought. And then Rook's Rest, just going back to that, the scene with the dragons. And I was just like, there are some high points in this season. I just hate that they focus so much on this Harrow Hall plotline that parts of it is overshadowing some of the high points that happened this season.
Here's what's funny. I'll tell you what my third kind of high point was. I would say Jace Jaehaerys. It's Jaehaerys. That's his full name, right? Mm-hmm. I feel like in terms of characters, he was probably like my top three from this season. But my third high point, honestly, that made me go, I want to see how everybody's going to react, is when the twin brothers fought. Now, the concept of that was stupid, because I'm like, I would assume that they like got passwords and they're better at communicating. And Rhaenyra's not dumb enough to like overlook the fact that, yeah, this dude got a twin brother. Let's make sure you don't sneak in. But I like that we saw Rhaenyra in a place of shock where it's like, girl, you kind of vulnerable. Yeah. Like, your best knight basically just offed himself because he couldn't handle everything he went through for you. And, like, I wanted to see her cry. Like, I want to see her cry from that. Like, girl, that's your knight. Like, that's the one who been by your side from the jump and said, F my family, F the kingdom. I serve you. I serve honor. I serve the crown.
And we just moved on to the next plot line. They buried him, moved on to the next plot line. And I guess another thing, if we just want to give the fact that we're in war, I just, how much do you give for people to grieve if we have to focus on the next thing and the next thing and the next thing and the next thing?
But you remember this, tell me if I'm wrong about this. The issue is that if you don't let us see them grieve or struggle with the fact that they can't grieve, it seems rushed when they go to madness, i.e. Daenerys in the final season.
I feel you.
If we don't see those moments for them to break down or struggle with the fact that they're having to be leaders, we saw Rhaenyra a little bit.
We saw her pick up a sword. Well, I would say the first episode is a really good example of that, like with the aftermath of Lucerys and how she basically wasn't even at the castle. Like, her whole council is sitting there. Where's the queen? Like, what do we need to do? Exactly. Like, what's our next moves? Like, we need an army. We need some and dragons. And that
was
a good
episode. We saw everybody breaking down. Jace was upset. Everybody was upset.
But then, like, after that, and I want to compare that to, like, the reaction to, like, Rhaenys. Like, I thought we were going to get to that next episode after Rook's Rest, and everybody was just going to be, like, shattered. Like,
Corlys was going to be toe up.
Like, we didn't lost one of our best hitters. Like,
exactly.
But we get that one scene of Corlys sitting in the chair with the tear rolling down his face. Rhaenyra and Bela have a heart-to-heart, but I was like,
if that scene fell flat, I'm like, do you even care about her?
I'm not the only one. Because I was like,
I love you, girl.
I was like, am I a heartless bitch or am I not feeling this right now?
No, it didn't seem, and maybe it's character chemistry, but it just didn't seem genuine. Like if I lost, because Rhaenys is technically like her grandma aunt to Bela, technically.
Her grandma aunt.
Because her daughter had like slept with Daemon, and that's how the old girl was born.
Okay.
And then like Daemon is like a cousin, is like Viserys' brother, and you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, okay.
That's a grand, like a grandma aunt, I think that's what you'll call her.
Yeah.
So if Rhaenys is her grandma aunt, and Rhaenyra's over here like, I love Rhaenys, like, I'm like, Foop, if I lost my grandma aunt, is that how you gonna console me?
it's like I have to say something to her. What should I just
like, they kind of did it like, oh my gosh, you know she didn't like me at first, okay, what comes after that, baby girl?
I honestly feel like the aftermath of Rook's Rest went more to Aegon and Aemon and everybody who was in King's Landing more than it did Dragonstone, because like,
yeah,
because Aegon and that's where it's going back to like the picking and choosing thing. Like, you have 8 episodes and you have to pick and choose, you know, who do you give like this big piece of the pie to? And I would say for the aftermath of Rook's Rest, I think that more went to everybody in King's Landing, because that was one of the things where Aegon was like, oh, Aemon is not my brother. We are not bros. Like, you know. And that's when Alicent was like, okay, this is getting a bit extreme. And then, like how you were saying earlier with Christian Cole, when he was finally getting like that, like getting that, like, this is war. This is what war with dragons looks like.
Exactly. Like, you want to know what it was? You know how a story has like an overarching theme or tone? Mm-hmm. And for seasonal seasons like this, it could be episodic. The bulk of this season, just based on what the characters went through, should have been grief, mourning, and sorrow. That should have been the undertone. But when that tonality should have been set, it wasn't set well. That's what I would say. It seemed as if the writer struggled to bring that to fruition. Because everybody was. Aegon lost his throne, lost his body, lost his power. You lost his son. His wife lost his son. Alicent lost her power, lost the support of the one person who's been in her corner her entire life.
Mm-hmm.
Christian Cole basically lost his second lover and lost his resolve. Rhaenyra lost a son. We got that grief.
Right.
But then she also lost this...
her hand.
Her hand, her knight, her aunt, grandma, whatever Rhaenys would be to her aunt, cousin.
That's what I was saying, her hand. Rhaenys was her hand.
Yeah. Like, out of everybody that this lost, Jacerys. He lost his closest brother.
Mm-hmm.
Bela, which out of the girls, Bela was the one that's actually still at Dragonstone, right?
Yeah,
which one's the one that was out in the field?
Side note.
Bela should have been mourning Rhaena more. And we can get into her. We can get into Rhaena.
Side note, Rhaena, I hope she gets that goddamn dragon. That whole last episode with her running through the field like she was Troy Bolton from High School Musical 2.
I was like, she better get that goddamn
away. We didn't see her running through the woods.
And I'ma say this, bro. If they really wanted that finality to hit, that should not have been a teaser. She should have either got ate by that dragon or got on it.
I think she's getting the dragon. The couple bits and pieces that I've been getting from the book readers on Twitter is that there is a third character to that, another character to that puzzle.
That Netta character or something. Yeah,
that gets that dragon. But they're giving her storyline to Rhaena, which isn't something that's unfamiliar to the Game of Thrones franchise, because they did the same thing in the original series where they removed extra characters and gave their plots to the major characters. But I was just like, damn, her whole thing this whole season was, I want a dragon. And we end off the season with her just looking at it. And I was just, and she better get that dragon. I'm telling you, if 2026 comes and she's still running in the field chasing after that dragon, go on here, wrap that up too. Wrap that up.
But that's why I can't get mad at the folks who are on social media saying this felt like a huge trailer. Because mm-hmm. I'm like, y'all set like 3 or 4 different cliffhangers in one episode. That should have been the one thing where happened.
And let's talk about those cliffhangers. So we got Rhaena with the dragon. Going backwards, we have Alicent, who is basically giving up Aegon to Rhaenyra.
Is she about to betray her kingdom?
Right. Telling her, give her 3 days time. Was it 3 days? She said. Yeah. She said, give me 3 days to put everything in place. And you and Daemon and your armies can come to King's Landing and we can end this. But Dan, let's go. Maybe it's forward or a little bit backwards after that. Aegon's gone. So how's that going? Ow. How's that going to play out? When Rhaenyra, when Alicent gets there and Aegon's gone, and she didn't tell Rhaenyra that she's going to get this stuff in place, and Rhaenyra, if Rhaenyra takes the bait and shows
now
up.
Now she think Alicent done set her up. Is Rhaenyra finna get offed? We don't know what's finna happen.
Is Alicent finna get off? Because coming off the ending of episode 7, Rhaenyra has the upper hand when it comes to dragons. At this point, they got what? 7 dragons?
So you try to trap me, girl?
Right. Like, that could get real bad real quick. And then if we're talking about, so let's, you know, go into the fact that they said that House of the Dragon is going to end with season 4.
Mm-hmm.
When exactly is Aegon supposed to come back? Like, are we going to even see him at all season 3? Because season 3 sounds like we finna go to war. The way they done showed everybody, like the other cliffhangers, when they showed everybody marching and going to war, the Lannisters on back, Tywin is on his way back.
The Starks are coming from the north.
Right, everybody seems to be marching on the field. It sounds like season 3, we finna go to war. Are we gonna see Aegon at all?
We finna have sea battles. We finna have battles in the land. We finna have dragon battles. Like, it's finna be a lot.
And then let's talk about, because we really didn't dive into Daemon's vision, but Daemon having the vision of basically what is the Song of Ice and Fire. Like, what, at on one end of the spectrum, it was motivation for him to get his shit together and wrap this up. But also, like, is that going to play into anything going forward?
Is he going to think that, does he know after that vision? Because the way they showed it, it's like, yeah, I see a blonde girl with dragons, obviously a Targaryen. I see the White Walkers, they look dangerous, and I see someone walking through blood. Is he going to think that Daenerys is his daughter? So, is he going to think that they need to have a kid? Is he going to, does he know that that's years and years ahead?
So, I know on first look, everybody thought it was Daenerys. Well, obviously, to us, that's Daenerys.
To us, we know it's Daenerys.
Because I was looking like, Daenerys? Like, what's really going on? But the way that Ryan Condal, the writer, showrunner of the series, he explained it, is that's not Daenerys. Like, from Daemon's point of view, like, we should see it as it's not Daenerys. Like, he's just having a vision of, you know, somebody, the princess who was promised. And you remember after they showed Daenerys, they showed Rhaenyra on the throne, which is basically, he was saying to look at it as to secure their future, Rhaenyra has to be on the throne. Basically hardening his resolve that he needs to get his shit together and stand by Rhaenyra's side. If they're going to, you know, if their bloodline is going to live on, and if they're going to stand a chance against these White Walkers, the whole winter is coming thing coming in the future.
Yeah. I hate to say it, it felt like it was just a way to make the fans like GOT a little happy.
But the thing that pisses me off, like, even after all of that, we already know how this ends. I was like, this whole scene, this whole, like, revelation that Daemon just had, like, even though it motivates him to stand by Rhaenyra's side and to get off the bullshit, at the end of the day, this is all for naught. What they be saying on Game of Thrones, this is all for naught.
It is all for naught.
This is all for nothing, because we know what happens at the end of Game of Thrones season 8. And I was like, this just pissed me off. All over again.
Like, honestly, at this point, y'all's focus should not be, oh my gosh, let's throw in Game of Thrones Easter eggs to make the fans happy. We got enough of that in season 1. We're just happy to see the same logos from the Starks. We're good. make this House of the Dragon a standalone quality story with quality characters. That should be y'all's focus.
I I'm hoping that's their last time doing it, because they're trying to wrap this up with 4 seasons. It's already been announced that season 3 is also going to have 8 episodes. And what it's looking like is that now we're about to get into the nitty-gritty for the Dance of Dragons. Now, my next hot take is that when we discussed season 1, George R.R. Martin said it is going to take 4 full seasons of 10 episodes each to do justice to the Dance of the Dragons from start to finish. With season 3 being 8 episodes, with a possibility that this might continue and season 4 is going to be 8 episodes, do you feel like we're going to get a fulfilling ending for House of the Dragon? Or do you feel like this is going to be another Game of Thrones season 8 situation?
It's a 50-50, because with the way they handled time skips and the way they ended season 1,
mm-hmm.
season 1 was fantastic. Season 1 made us all go, Game of Thrones is back. That's all you saw over social media. We were shouting that from the rooftops. Season 2 made us go, we're seeing season 8 vibes. So for me, it's 50-50. I don't know. If the writers do some good pacing, if they do good character development, if the episodes are long enough, because at the end of the day, even if y'all were given 20 episodes, bad writing is bad writing. Mm-hmm. Bad pacing is bad pacing. That can impact your vision, but not as much as the quality of your mindset when you put pen to paper mm-hmm. at the end of the day. So I think it's 50-50. If season 3 is bad, and I have some theories for it, but if season 3 is bad, then I'm assuming that season 4 is going to be bad too. I think we won't get a good finale if season 3 is bad.
I would say it's fair to say 50-50, because if anything, like, I don't hate this season, but I this truly felt like a filler season. Like an in-between, bridging the gaps of the aftermath of season 1 and putting all the pieces in place for season 3. I think the only issue that I feel like some people are having is the way that they promoted season 2, because
that did play a part, yeah.
The way that they promoted it, they made it seem like, dude, it's wartime. Like, we're finna get to the business, and then we get here and it's a lot of, you know, planning and let's do this and a lot of like exposition and stuff like that. And I'm not saying that's bad, because now, you know, as we just talked about, we can see where all of this is leading up to. But I think it's just the way that they promoted it. Like, they didn't promote it to where this is going to be like a filler season.
Yeah. But I will say this, and because now that we're at this 47-minute mark, we did a lot of negatives. I will say this. Some of the war times was good. Let's give them some credit. I know, but I want us to dedicate more time to the positives. Rook Rest had me tearing up. That was absolutely fire.
That was a nice dragon fight. Actually, that was a nice dragon fight. A 2v1, and Rhaenys was handling their ass.
And remind me, just making sure I ain't forgetting, didn't they see Christian Cole and Allison's brother beforehand when Bela was like, oh, I almost dove down to bite him, but he went into the forest.
That was one of the other episodes. Build-up.
Yeah, even that build-up, I was like, okay, so we finna see some good dragon action. And we got some good dragon action.
Rex Rest was a really good episode. R.I.P. Rhaenys.
R.I.P. the GOAT.
That was my girl. Like, I don't know, but that was a good episode.
That was a great way to end a great character. Like, the way she could have flew off, because at first I was in my head, I'm like, she's stupid. But then it's also like, no, she promised right now she's going to do what she has to do. Right now, the king and the fake king and the runner-up, his brother on the largest dragon, are right here. You got one of the best dragons that has a rider at the moment. Mm-hmm. The second to, what's the dragon's name? I'm forgetting right now. I'm going blank.
Vhagar.
Second best dragon to Vhagar. Like, yeah, you're going in.
Oh, wait, your damage. What dragon are you talking about? Vhagar is Aemon's dragon. What dragon?
Yeah, Aemon's dragon. I was like, Rhaenys is riding one of, like, currently the second best dragon that has a rider to Vhagar right now.
Okay, got it.
Like, she did a thing. She went in, she did some damage. She got Aegon down. She tore up his beautiful golden dragon doll that couldn't have done nothing in the first place. She did her business. She handled business. She did a good job.
Yeah. I just... And, like I said, I hate that this Daemon plot, like, overshadowed or is and is overshadowing a lot of, like, the positives that happen in this season. Because I'm just going to say this. I wasn't prepared for that. I thought we was finna go to war, and if we was going to do exposition, I promise you, that was at the bottom of my list.
Even if they did exposition, it should have just been better.
But I would agree that everybody, I would say that there are characters that had their moment. Like Helena, when she basically stuck it to Aemon at the end, when he was like, I get in your life for this, and she was like, it won't change nothing. I was like, she eating your ass up. And like, it's Aemon in that big ass dragon. When he's even the RIP Rhaenys, but the way that Aemon be sneaking with that big fat ass dragon, gotta give it to him. And like I said in one of our previous episodes, the man stands on business. He does not play.
I watched a video that broke down the dragons, and it's funny because the reason Vhagar has to do that is because like she is slow. Like, she's big and slow, so as a battle-trained dragon, she knows that she has to go for sneak shots, and she get them every time.
She get them every time.
Like, her name should have been Big Shrek or something.
Please.
Shrekar.
Like, Rhaenyra, as bad as that situation did, Rhaenyra did her big one when she put all them folks in that damn dragon pit and was like, may the odds ever be in y'all favor.
It was giving may the odds be ever in your favor.
Like, yo, I was like, what in the Hunger Games is going on?
And she looks so intimidated when she said Vermithor, serve, and just stood there with the dragon right behind her like, all right, good luck. Like, what?
The way that the plot line is moving, I want to say, like, Rhaenyra, you have to pay for that. Like, so, like, somebody, we have to do something. It's not gonna happen. What's done is done, y'all.
And one thing I kind of wanted to feed into, like, Rhaenyra do got her dark side. Like, I think the showrunners really try to make her and Alicent seem like these softies that you should root for. But that was kind of dark, and we ain't really leaning into that. Like, that was some.
I don't think they ever made Rhaenyra soft. If you want to say soft in regards that she wasn't, like, up and ready to fight, like how Aemon and Aegon were when things happen. But I would always say that Rhaenyra always saw things, like, differently. Like, while Alicent was all, like, a stick in the board with her beliefs and her righteousness and stuff. Like, I feel like Rhaenyra was always, like, the one to go against the grain.
Not soft. I feel like they don't feed into their desires and their aggressiveness. Like, Alicent really had her moments where it's like, it almost seemed as if it was out of character because we don't lean into it much. Like, when she looked at Aegon and he was crying and she was just drinking her little her boba tea this time around. Do nothing. Do nothing. Rhaenyra really came up in here with, like, stick face, like, stern BF, like, you know, resting BF face. And she just was like, good luck, and, like, walked away.
The funniest thing about that scene, she was like, okay, there's nothing else I can show you. Bye. What?
That's what I'm saying. Like, I was like, are y'all could lean more into their dark side, because that is kind of like, y'all got to do what y'all got to do.
I feel like at that point, though, is that because there was a point, like, after Rook's rest, Rhaenyra was like, you know, I've tried all of, like, the peacemaking. I've tried to be, like, the reasonable person, but ain't no about being reasonable. And that, I feel like that was, like, the first step.
The response.
Right. The first step of stepping into, like, we can't be reasonable no more. I need dragons. Put them folks on them boats. Who makes it, you know, it is what it is. Like, and I feel like because she did that, then moving on to season 3, we may see her taking some more questionable choices, making some more questionable decisions, where it's like, Rhaenyra...
The only thing that makes me go, there's a lack of consistency, is the moment where Alicent came into her castle. Because if you can do that, and now your friend is here, And maybe it's because Alicent made that offer and that made Rhaenyra go, oh my gosh, yeah, let's do it. But then at the same time, if you know you got the upper hand with all your dragons, you ain't even got to worry about this. Man, take her head.
I feel like that. It could be two things. My number one reason is I feel like they both have a soft spot for each other. Like, even with all everything that's been going on. I mean, you looking at me sideways, but as you see, Rhaenyra did not lock her up, did not feed her to the dragons, did not call the guards. So somebody got a soft spot for somebody.
I'm saying that soft spot should have froze over and became a rock. And
if we want to go back the past, my second reason, if we want to go the past couple episodes, she might have been returning the favor of when she snuck into King's Landing, confronted Alicent in the crypt, and Alicent didn't call no guards, didn't call no dragons, didn't tell nobody.
Even then, I felt like that scene was kind of stupid. I feel like that scene was...
I feel like what I was just saying before, I feel like Rhaenyra did that because she was trying to do everything possible but go to war, bloodshed. And when Alicent was like, you know, what's done is done, and then the situation that happened at Rook's Rest, Rhaenyra was basically like, you know what, cut it. Because even as Alicent was explaining her, she was like, you know, I was wrong, and like, you know, I just want to be free from this and all of that. Rhaenyra was laughing in her face, and she was like, girly pop, it is too late for you to be sneaking into my castle telling me that you was wrong and you feel bad.
But that's what I'm saying. Like, because it's like, nah, it's too late. I tried. That's where I would have been like, if you can let all these folks who you serve, because you was taught by your father that the lowborn are the ones that y'all lead and y'all work for. If you can off them and you supposedly care about them, and now the queen, the king's consort queen is here, man, lock her up. See what you can do to her as to use as a bargaining chip or something.
I just don't see how you can do that and not let her go. That's why I feel like the number one reason is just they have a soft spot for each other. That's the only thing. That's my number one reason of why none of them things happen. Because I was also looking like, yeah, we going to King's Landing, but you going in this dungeon. If it was me, yeah, we going to King's. We might investigate what you just told me, but you not leaving this castle. But I just feel like they have, I feel like the recurring theme between Alicent and Rhaenyra is that even though they're at odds, is that there's something in them that has a soft spot for each other that allows moments like that.
I guess I don't like that soft spot coming as a fan of GOT. Because in OG GOT, Daenerys, Cersei, ain't letting that happen. The women from GOT ain't letting that happen. I know it's a new series, but at the same time, if we're saying it's written by this one person and he had a great vision for it, and I ain't read the books, I feel like that consistency of how some of these characters would act in like Game of Thrones growing up, that wasn't there.
But you also have to go back to the fact of what you said of how Fire and Blood was written versus how Game of Thrones was written. Like, they had way more source material to work from to craft characters like Cersei and Daenerys. And we can even talk about Sansa and how she was plotting against Daenerys in like season 8. We can even talk about Arya. But I feel like they had a lot of evidence behind it. Whereas if what you're telling me, if Fire and Blood is written like a historical novel, then some of that stuff.
But that's what I'm saying. Even if you study Game of Thrones and if you're maintaining those themes, women in Game of Thrones ain't just these soft flowers that love each other and like their friendships will prevent them from handling business. Because the women in Game of Thrones, all them girls you just named, Sansa loved her golden king, but at some point it was, I'm gonna let some dogs feast on some dude who hurt me. Like, this girl's son, off Joe's son, you can say a son for son, even though you kind of took her son, Daemon did it, but...
Well, let's be realistic then. They need Alicent for something. I think from what I've seen is that Alicent does make it to the end out of all this.
Which is so interesting.
They need her for something. So if we want to talk realistically of why Rhaenyra didn't lock her ass up, feed her to the dragons.
Plot armor.
Yeah, they need her for something.
And I guess for me.
And I hear you. I hear you. I hear you. I hear you.
Game of Thrones has some of the best just male and female characters.
But I feel like going back to my argument, all of these seasons, except the last two, had 10 episodes.
I would say that we knew what type of character Cersei was when she pushed a little boy off a towel because she wanted to sleep with her brother. I'm sorry.
But she ain't pushing.
We saw what type of girl she was by episode 6 when Ned got his head cut off and she said, oh.
Listen.
Oh. She said, oh.
Listen. Listen.
Was that episode six?
I thought that was the last episode when they did that.
That was the last episode when that happened. That was like kind of in the middle, wasn't it? Or am I tripping?
I feel like that was like maybe it was close to the end. I don't feel like it was six though.
It wasn't 10 and it wasn't 9.
I don't think it was. Look, we ain't come here to talk about what episode of Game of Thrones Ned Stark got the pokey. But look.
The pokey or the slashy slashy?
The slashy slashy.
The hokey pokey, the slashy bashy.
The slashy slashy. Look. The only thing that I have to say about season 3, because now we know that, you know, they're about to get into like the intense battle stuff. Like,
yeah.
Shit's about to hit the fan. Like, the shit was spinning. The fan was spinning. We was building up the little turd, and now the shit is hitting the fan. Season 3. The only thing that I have to say with this 8 episode thing is that we need to decide on these plot lines, what we want to focus on and what we don't want to focus on a little bit better.
So, can we get into theories?
Yeah.
Because I have something to bring up. So, I've not spoiled myself. I have managed to avoid spoilers. Unless it was a few things that was like people comparing the books to what's going on now. I'm glad House of the Dragon fans, y'all doing well at not doing spoilers. Shout out to y'all. Y'all need to teach the JJK manga read or something.
Don't go on TikTok. But if you've been on Twitter, I won't. Yeah. Spoilers going wild on TikTok.
That's crazy. But if I had a theory, and book readers, don't tell me if I'm right or wrong. Just be like, keep going. But I feel like Rhaenyra messed up, and well, it's not that she messed up. She had two bad decisions, and she made a bad one. And I feel like Christian Cole messed up because when I looked at the foreshadowing, and a lot of people's like a dragon dying is a bad omen. Mm-hmm. And there was one person in the walkway when he was walking through the King's Landing who said, "They're not gods; they're just pieces of meat."
Right.
And then you follow up and you see Jace say, what makes us different from the lowborn, and it's just the fact that they're highborn. Like, that's the good excuse they gave them.
Mm-hmm.
One, I feel like they've deteriorated the name Targaryen and the value of dragons. And two, if I recall, the dude who was quiet, one of the dragon seeds, the new dragon rider for Vermithor, I can't remember his name, Hugh. He mentioned that his mother basically said, "You're no different from my other sons." And she mentioned Viserys and Daemon. So is he their half-brother?
Yeah.
If he's aware of that, and he now has the second biggest dragon, I'm sorry. We keep looking at that drunk dude thinking he's the one who's going to, like, probably betray them or be the reason that makes them go, oh my gosh, we should never give him lowborn dragons. I think he was going to betray Rhaenyra the second Daemon is going. I mean, not Daemon, Aemon is going.
Because
if he has the second biggest dragon and he says he has just as much legitimacy to the throne as Daemon once had, and now he has the second biggest dragon to basically to take the throne by force if they can defeat Vhagar together. Mm-hmm. I'm worried about that.
I would be interested to see how that plan works out, because I think it's very obvious that we're not about to be 1-1 with the book. So I would be interested to see the writer's take on how that plays out now that we have three dragon riders that aren't full Targaryen or are not nobleborn. How does that play out with like their upbringing and their ways of life and their beliefs? And now you done gave these people a dragon, no background check, no who's your mama, who's your daddy, like exactly. what do you do for a living? Just here's a dragon.
And these folks from the bars, the folks who was on Corlys's boats, they recognized these people. They were amongst the people because they were the people. So my question is, let's assume that Aemon does lose. Let's say they do defeat Vhagar. What comes after that? Somebody's going to die. I don't know if it's Jacerys. I don't know if it's his wife, cousin, sister-in-law, half-sister, whatever. I don't know how that's going to go and who's going to die. But if Vermithor survives and Hugh survives, what's stopping him from saying, your husband is my brother and I have just as much legitimacy to the throne as he does, and my dragon bigger than yours?
The only thing that I could think of is...
Because that would be a... If we're going off
what we've heard in, like, Game of Thrones and what we're talking about, like, basically, like, general knowledge of how the Dance of Dragons basically, like, diminish the whole Targaryen family to, like...
They tore themselves up, basically.
Mm-hmm. It doesn't... I can see some betrayal happening, but I don't see it happening to that extent. It could be a thought. It could be like a seed planted. But I don't know how far they would get.
I feel like if I had to place my bets, he's the one that I think is going to do some dirty stuff. Because I feel like, and this is if we got good writers, because I feel like the writers makes the fans think if somebody was to betray Rhaenyra, it would be the drunk dude. I wouldn't put it past the writers if the drunk dude somehow saves Rhaenyra from Dragonfire and sacrifices himself.
Get his shit together.
You see what I'm saying? I wouldn't be surprised if Corlys's son, who gets mad at him for being a bastard, and he goes and burn him on the boats. Because I got to see how the Lannisters take control.
That's the wrong brother. Allen is the one that snapped on him at the end. Adam is the one that has the dragon.
Yeah, but Adam was also the one who was telling Alan, hey, why don't you, like, do you wonder how he feels in his throne? He was the one telling his brother, hey, you should be more desiring. You should be a little bit more passionate like I am.
I don't know. And maybe I have faith in Adam. Maybe I have too much faith in Adam, but I don't see him betraying Rhaenyra.
I think it just makes sense, and it would be fun if Hugh eventually, for some reason, I don't know why, was like, I'm going against y'all, and that would be the fall of the Targaryen family. Because
I don't have any suspicions about Allen, but the other two, Hugh and Ulf, I can buy into that theory that one of them gonna get too big for their britches. I got me a dragon, y'all, what's up?
And it's like, just look at how empowered they feel. You got these lowborn, and we end the episode with them getting dressed.
He pissed me off when he was like, bring out some of them more little birds. I was like, can you have some decorum at this table right now? Some coof?
I'm gonna be real. That was realistic. Let's just think about it. You drag a smack talker from the bar who's already a little drunk. All he do is go drink at the bar with his homeboys, and he been saying, I'm a Targaryen bastard. I'm a bastard. And now I got a dragon? I'm talking my smack. I was going to die from starvation anyway. I'm up.
I'm just saying, maybe we don't bite the hand that feeds you. Maybe you don't talk smack to the lady that gave you a dragon.
How big is his dragon even compared to Rhaenyra's?
But if we're sitting at the dinner table, and if Rhaenyra was the type of person, if she was the Cersei type of person that was like, you know what, I'm done with you, we don't really need you for real, and his entrance and exit is the same day, then what? It doesn't matter how big his dragon is.
You're right, but it's not like in these dragon fights, everybody just comes out clean. Like, even if you get two of the biggest dragon and another one attacking you, just like with Rhaenys and Aemon and Aegon, people are getting burnt up. And if Rhaenyra's on her, I don't want to hurt more people, having a dragon just puts you on close to equal footing with everybody who has one at that point. Like, Jace don't really got power over this dude no more. Jace's dragon is tiny.
Yeah.
Rhaenyra's dragon is decently sized, but Ulf's dragon is about the same size, right? Ain't his dragon about as old?
Whose dragon?
Ulf's dragon. Which dragon did he get?
He got silver wing.
It looked like a decent size. It didn't seem like Rhaenyra's was just that much bigger.
I just feel like it could. I'm not saying that it couldn't happen. I just want everybody to act right. Golly, because if we finna,
unless they all get that witch juice that Daemon got. I don't put it past nobody. I feel like if season three is all wars and battles, somebody betraying Rhaenyra.
Yeah.
Somebody betraying her.
Yeah.
Daemon might die protecting her. It might be Ulf who comes up and surprises us as the drunkard and he protects her. But some going down.
Yeah.
And I put my money on Hugh. If we, once season three comes out in 2026.
Yeah.
And if I remember that we made these theories, hopefully when one of us video edits, we see who was right.
Do you remember August 2024 when you said...
The bastards were going to rise against
them. I mean, I don't debunk that theory that one of these new dragon riders will betray her, because I don't feel like at the end of the day that they really owe her any loyalty. Like, you just picked me up off the street and gave me a dragon. Like, you don't really know nothing about me. So that's why I'm saying it's not far-fetched.
Look, I don't know what's going to happen, but that just seemed like, I feel like out of all the foreshadowing, the way they say it, like, y'all done lowered the value of dragons, y'all done lowered the value of having dragon
riders. But I feel like that's going into the fall of House Targaryen. I feel like that's all playing into part of the fall of House Targaryen.
Yeah.
And why it was so monumental for Daenerys to pop up with three dragons. And everything that happened in Game of Thrones, because of what's happening in House of the Dragon, is just bringing the value of Targaryens and dragons down to this low state that when it comes back up, it's like, girl, we ain't seen this in like 160 years. Like, what?
Exactly. And this is one of those things where it's like, it's not a video game, so you can't just go to a codex. But I'm like, Daenerys had three dragons and there just weren't any other Targaryens to like bond with the other ones, and she always rode Drogon. But I'm like, the way Rhaenyra was able to tell Vermithor, like, serve, girl, you can't tell him to come about that cave and breathe fire on King's Landing. Like, he can't fly with you because Daenerys had it down pat. Like,
but
she had three.
But I also feel like the difference between what's going on in House of the Dragon and Game of Thrones is that there was an order to things when it came to dragons in House of the Dragon. Like, it seems like it seems uncommon, or it seems
it's an unknown known. Like, y'all don't know that y'all could do this.
Right. Or it's like, it's a set rule that, you know, you can't claim multiple dragons. Like, you get your dragon and that's your dragon. Because at this point, you know, there's going to be more Targaryens. And, you know, the rite of passage of being a purebred Targaryen is getting your dragon.
Inbred Targaryen.
It's still pure.
Pure inbred.
But listen, but when we get to Daenerys' time, she doesn't know any of that. Like, she doesn't know that history. She doesn't know those rite of passages. She doesn't know the politics and everything that comes into, oh, you get this one dragon. Like, she is, I mean, besides Jon effing Snow, she is the last Targaryen. So she pops up with three dragons. These my dragons.
And remind me, remember the scorpion ballistas that they had in Game of Thrones, where Cersei just did her research and was like, these existed to hunt down dragons. Are those the same ballistas that they already got in King's Landing when a dragon flies through?
Yeah, I can't remember who I was talking to, but yeah, those, I saw those in Game of Thrones, but I think Cersei was the only one who thought about it and was like, put them on the boats. And that's how we got to season 8.
Okay, so they was always aware that a ballista could do damage to dragons.
Yeah.
So it makes me wonder, and I don't know if we're ever going to see this, but like, Betharion, the biggest dragon whose skull was like sitting in the castle, is that the name of that dragon?
Balerion. Balerion the Dread.
Yeah, but like, when dragons die, they don't really talk about dragons going against dragons, but they do allude to the fact that when dragons go to war, people die. It makes me wonder, like, when dragons died in the past, would y'all like cover up their bodies so that y'all don't send those bad omens to the people? Like, what would y'all do back when a dragon died or was off because a Targaryen went wild and y'all had to fight him? Like, that's one of those things that you would only learn if it was like a video game and you could like
go through the codex notes. Well, I don't know. Maybe they had them for if a dragon went rogue, like, you know, a put down, we need to put you down type of mythic because you're like not acting right. Like the wild dragon. Because I feel like before, they didn't have like conflicts with each other. Like, I feel like the Dance of the Dragons, what's going on with the House of the Dragons is like the first huge conflict between House Targaryen that basically just took them down.
So I wonder how they handled wild dragons, because we do got that one wild dragon in Vale.
But that's what I'm saying. Maybe that's what they were for.
Only the wild ones, and maybe they just told the people like, "Hey, that's not a Targaryen dragon. That's like we don't know this dragon.
We tried to tame it. It's still acting a fool around here." Let's go ahead and put it down. Maybe there were some other dragons that existed. They were being chill at first, and then they start cutting up. Okay, listen.
Yeah.
They cutting up too bad.
Okay.
I don't think they ever used it to like, oh, there go my homeboy. You know, I really don't like him. And then, you know, shoot him out the sky.
I was going to, and I'm going to ask you about this theory and how you feel about this one. Because it's Sea Smoke was the one that originally belonged to Daenerys' cousin husband.
Rhaenyra.
Rhaenyra's cousin husband. Mm-hmm. So from what I understand, dragons can only bond with one rider until that rider dies. Some people were theorizing that this is a sign that because he bonded with Rhaenyra's cousin husband's half-brother, that it's because Buddy died off-screen. Do you think that that's what happened, or you think they're just making some other stuff up?
I mean, it could be. Like, at the way that this story is going, I see no reason for him to come back up. I can't remember.
I don't see a reason for him to come back either.
I don't see a reason for him to come back. So if he did pass, then, you know, RIP. But
RIP.
So I feel like at this point we got bigger fish to fry.
Dragons to fry.
We got bigger fish to fry, and it's dragons.
Mm-hmm.
But okay. We'll see. We got 2 years to find out whether or not our theories prove right or not. Did you have anything else?
No, I think that was it.
All right. So let's go ahead and wrap this up. So once again, Ryan, thank you for joining me on another episode of the Blerd Mob Podcast. Shout out to everybody who is watching and listening, whether this is your first time or your 50th time tuning in. It is always appreciated. Like I said, let us know in the comments how you felt about this episode, how you felt about House of the Dragon Season 2, and if you have any theories going towards Season 3, let us know too. Make sure you follow us on social media so you can stay caught up with all of the black and nerdy things we're up to as far as anime, video games, comics, and other TV and movies coming up. We're on Instagram at the Blerd Mob Pod. You can find us on Twitter at the Blerd Mob, and you can find us on TikTok and Facebook at the Blerd Mob Podcast. And make sure you check out that description for ways to donate to the mob. All donations goes to equipment and all of the software we use to bring you all these lovely episodes. And with that all being said, this is the mob checking out. Peace. Now that Zhao has admitted that him and Azula were conspiring against him, I don't think there is anything that Azula could tell him along the lines of what happened at season 2 to be like, hey, father says whatever, you know, come